Welcome, visitors, scholars, and others to Transpacific Engagements. And good afternoon, good evening. We know that people are with us today from many different time zones. I'm Mary Miller, director of the Getty Research Institute, or the GRI. We start our program today by acknowledging Getty presence on the traditional ancestral and unceded territory of the Gabrielino Tongva peoples. And I particularly welcome those of you who are watching this YouTube at some later date. It's one of the things we think we're in this moment, but we know this moment can have a longer life. On this occasion, we're hoping to circle the globe with our audience, reaching out intentionally to colleagues around the world, and we believe that people are tuning in today from Australia, Canada, Chile, China, Colombia, Guam, India, Italy, Mexico, Panama, Philippines, Singapore, Spain, Sweden, Switzerland, the UK, and of course the United States. And we're delighted to have so many esteemed leaders of visual inquiry with us today as well. In the United States, we are coming together at a time of some pain. 2 years ago today, on May 25th, George Floyd was murdered with callous racist disregard. And just a week ago, we learned of a shocking crime here in Southern California targeting our local Asian community. In a time when hatred and relentless gun violence divides communities, the research underlying this event and the book it presents, and I have it here with me today, reminds us of the power of connections between cultures and the beauty that can result from cross-cultural artistic exchange. In our coming together today, let us celebrate the art, culture, and scholarship that has for centuries bound the Americas to Asia via Transpacific Engagements. Today, we celebrate the release of the edited volume that I've been holding up here, Transpacific Engagements, Trade, Translation, and Visual Culture of the Entangled Empires, which results from a transoceanic collaboration between the Ayala Museum in Manila, the Kunsthistorische Institut in Florence, Max-Planck-Institut, and the Getty Research Institute here in Los Angeles. This is the third event in a book launch series organized with our partners to reflect the book's topic. The conversation today will explore global culture and economic exchange on the Trans-Pacific routes between Asia and the Americas from the 16th to the 19th centuries, an era of competition for global trade networks, and an examination of how those interchanges have made a profound impact on contemporary art and culture, especially in the cosmopolitan cities of Manila and Los Angeles along the Pacific Rim. I want to deeply thank our institutional partners, and above all, Dr. Nina Capistrano-Baker and Dr. Meha Priyadarshini, the editors of this book, for their unrelenting efforts to publish this work. Another big thank you to Chelsea Anderson, our events manager, who's here behind the scenes today, the AV techs, Paul Peters, Ron Bunny, and Adrian Casares in Trust Events, who are here behind the scenes to ensure a smooth run of show. And now I turn this program over to Kim Richter, Senior Research Specialist at the GRI, who will introduce our speakers and moderate the discussion. Please note that we will have time at the end of the presentations for questions from the audience, so please type your questions into the Q&A box at the bottom of the Zoom screen. And thank you. Kim?
Hello and good afternoon, everybody. Some slides to show, so I want to make sure you have to open these. There we go. So it's a pleasure to be here and to celebrate this new book that has arrived. And before I introduce our speakers, I wanted to give you all a little bit of a background of how this book came together. It really started at the GRI and conversations that we were having with our institutional partners, but especially with our 2013 and 2013 scholar year theme. We have annual fellowships where scholars come to the Getty Research Institute under a particular theme. And that year, the theme was Connecting Seas, Cultural and Artistic Exchange. And many people who contributed to the book were scholars in residence that year. And here is over here. Here you see some of them. So this was a wonderful group that conducted research all over the world. And it was made for very vibrant interchanges that also then contributed and were continued in Manila at the Ayala Museum, which was a wonderful symposium that we organized for the same year, Transpacific Engagements. And this was organized with the Kunsthistorische Institut in Florenz, the Ayala Museum, and the Getty Research Institute. And it was such a wonderful event, in particular because it brought scholars together who for many years had been working on this topic of Trans-Pacific engagements, but who'd never met each other in person. And so we had a wonderful group of scholars from the Philippines, and then we brought scholars that were in residence at the GRI. And so this was just made for a very fruitful discussion among all of us. And from that resulted this wonderful book that we're here to celebrate and learn about today. And so therefore it gives me great pleasure to introduce our speakers. Paulina Machuca is research professor at the Colegio de Michoacán in Mexico. And her research focuses on the history of biocultural exchanges between Mexico and the Philippines from the 16th to the 18th centuries. Among her most recent publications are the book coordinated with Tomás Calvo, México y Filipinas, Culturas y Memoria sobre el Pacífico, and Historia Mínima de Filipinas. In 2019, she also received the Francisco Javier Clavijero Award for the best history book in Mexico, El Vino de Cocos en la Nueva España, Historia de una Transculturación en el Siglo XVII. Also here today with us is Cristina Lee, Professor and Director of Graduate Studies of Spanish and Portuguese at the Princeton University. Her publications include Saints of Resistance, Devotions in the Philippines of Early Spanish Rule, Anxiety of Sameness in Early Modern Spain, and the Spanish Pacific, 1521 to 1815, A Reader of Primary Sources, created with Ricardo Padrón, and Western Visions of Far East in a Trans-Pacific Age. And we have also Richard Chu, who's professor of history at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. His research focuses on the history of Chinese diaspora in the Philippines, centering on issues of race, ethnicity, gender, empire, and nationalism. He is the author of The Chinese and Chinese Mestizo of Manila, Family, Identity, and Culture, 1860s to 1930s, editor of Moi Tsinoi Than We Need to Admit, and co-editor of More Tomboy, More Bakla Than We Admit, Insights into Sexual and Gender Diversity in Philippine Culture, History, and Politics. These are the main speakers, and then joining them are for the roundtable discussion after the presentations are Florina Capistrano Baker, who is consultant to the Ayala Museum in the Philippines, where she was formerly the museum director. Her research focuses on artistic global exchanges involving the Philippine specificities, whether within the context of the Indian Ocean, the South China Sea, for the Pacific Ocean. She is co-curator of Philippine Gold, Treasures of Forgotten Kingdoms at the Asian Society of Museum in New York, and author of the exhibition catalog by the same title. And she's co-editor, importantly for tonight, of Transpacific Engagements, Trade, Translation, and Visual Culture of Entangled Empires, 1565 to 1898. And she was also a Getty scholar during the Connecting Scholars Year, and you might have picked her out in that group photo, and also co-editor of the symposium that ultimately resulted to that book. And I just have to say, it's been so wonderful over all these years working with Nina to get to this point finally. And her co-editor is Meha Priyadarshini, who is lecturer in history and deputy director of the Center for Global History at the University of Edinburgh. She was a pre-doctoral scholar at the Getty, where she met Nina and I had a chance to meet her there, and then also was a presenter at the symposium in Manila. And then she also was a postdoctoral had a postdoctoral fellowship at the Kunsthistorische Institut. So she bridges oceans and institutions that are involved with all of this today, and is also the author of Chinese Porcelain in Colonial Mexico, The Material World of an Early Modern Trade, which came out in 2018. And I can't overstate how much the three partnering institutions, the GRI, the Kunst, and the Ayala Museum, are indebted to Nina and Meha for bringing the project to fruition over all these years. So welcome everybody, and we begin with Paulina. Paulina, you're still muted.
Thank you. Thank you, Meredith. Thank you, Kim, for this introduction. And I would like to start this presentation with a thought for the victims of Uvalde, Texas, yesterday. And well, first of all, I would like to thank the editors of the book and the Getty Research Institute for this kind invitation. It is a challenge for me to present this magnificent book in just 10 minutes because it is a work that has the contribution of 19 authors. And as a whole, it is a book extremely rich in information, in topics, and in images. So I will start. Can you see it, Kim?
Looks great, thank you.
So I would like to highlight three general elements of the book. First, that it is inserted in a renewed historiography on the studies of trans-Pacific relations from the modern era. First, the circulation of objects are seen not only as commodities, but as cultural and artistic expressions that involve the transfer of techniques and knowledge between different traditions. Second, the book is inscribed in the Pacific term, which emphasizes the role that played the Pacific Ocean as the engine of the first globalization. And third, the uses of concepts such as engagement and translation are really pertinent because the meaning of cultural translation goes beyond the analysis of a text, but it is transferred to the field of social practices. That is to say, how people who are originally from one place interpret their own reality when they enter a new locality, and how they put into practice all the previous cultural baggage. Based on these three reflections, I am going to refer to the topics addressed in the 19 chapters, but in a general way, since I don't have time to specify each one of them. Some opening chapters deal with the idea of empires, because empires have struggled to impose their own historical narratives within colonized places. For the Hispanic monarchy, the Philippines was portrayed as a global periphery that was inserted within the organicist vision, in which the royal body is made up of different members who collaborate in different ways. As Ricardo Padron explains, to this very well-known symbolic cartography. And why was the Philippines a global periphery from the Spanish monarchy? Because it was a melting pot of cultures, mainly from ethnic groups, Spanish and Chinese, but many other cultures from Southeast Asia and indirectly the Americas. It is what Fernando Chalcita calls a cradle of a fusion culture, because it is born from a mestizo world between different ethnic groups. In the same way, Feliz Prudente Santa Maria shows how Philippine cuisine was nourished thanks to the hundreds of plant species that came from the Americas, such as the cacao, achiote, sweet potato, and along, etc. But I maintain that the same cultural phenomenon happened in Mexico with the case of the coconut, the mango, or the tamarind. I allowed myself to put this photograph to show how drinks such as tuba of Filipino origin is the traditional drink of the city of Colima, Mexico, where hundreds of Filipinos settled during the 17th century. So, Fernando Chalcita spoke of a fusion culture, while Vicente Rafael, with a more geopolitical perspective, defines the Philippines as an imperial artifact, because if we take into account the 20th century, three empires overlapped in its creation: Spanish, the American, and even the Japanese. These empires have struggled to impose their own historical narratives within colonized places. The school was the strategic place used by the American administration to impose a new historical memory, and English as the lingua franca, as we can see in the image with an American teacher. The Philippines is not the only one at this imperial crossroads, and Sean Nelson explains the encounter between Kalakaua, the last king of Hawaii before the annexation of the United States, and Emperor Meiji. Kalakaua believed in a kind of pan-Asianism and considered Japan as a close nation biologically and culturally. Another topic is text and visual translation between different worlds. We all know that Spanish and Portuguese monarchies tried to conquer their colonies in Asia, not only by the sword, but also by the cross. And in this process, texts, paintings, and sculptures were produced and reinterpreted by different artisans, not only in the Philippines, but also in the Estado de India. Here we have a powerful image from the Shilu, a work by Juan Cobo, the first Dominican friar able to speak and write Chinese in the Philippines. Jose Antonio Cervera explains that in this image, the Dominican friar tries to convince that Christianity was a universal religion. Painting and sculpture were other means of evangelization. This is the case of the green men or the Hindu ratas studied by Esteban Garcia Aposo, where the Christian narrative had to be reinterpreted and adapted from local myths in India so that the converts themselves felt familiar. These adaptations are also present in the rocalla, or rocalla, the most characteristic element of the Rococo style that arrived in the Philippines in the mid-18th century. This artistic manifestation is studied by Regalado Trota Jose, who tells us that over time, oriental motifs such as pagodas and exotic birds were included, and even stone cutters from the Malabar coast of India participated in the elaboration of carved stones. Marcos Musillo explains how Chinese painters, but also the Europeans who traveled to China, had to reinvent themselves and adapt in order to represent the context in which they arrived. This is the case of Giuseppe Castiglione, a Jesuit from Italy who arrived at the Chinese court in 1715 and who painted the emperor with a monochromatic background and looking straight ahead according to court canons. This style differs from what Castiglioni had previously painted in Europe with its chiaroscuro. Conversely, Cantonese painters learned to paint in the Western style for an export market, as Jing Zhejiang analyzes. So we come back to the Philippines, where the foundation of the Academy of Drawing by Damian Domingo in 1829 was a watershed in Philippine painting known as miniaturism. It was a style, as Patrick Flores explained, that served to represent the Filipino elite, like in this illuminating portrait of the Quiasson family, in which the father reinforces the stereotypes of masculinity, of power, in front of a submissive wife who cares for children. The clothing tells us about the exquisiteness of Philippine textile rich, especially piña clothes, but also the decoration of the house portrays the European tastes and fashions of the wealthy classes of their time. And this image gives me the opportunity to talk about textiles, since there are two chapters dedicated to this subject. Elena Fitz discusses a later explored topic, which is the export of Philippine textiles made from local fibers, such as abaca or mendilyake, and later piña clothes. The great debate, I believe is still open, is from when the production of pineapple textiles began and if they reached the Americas before the end of the galleon trade in 1815. What it is true is that pineapple became the most celebrated fabric and a symbol of national identity during the 19th century, as Sandra Castro analyzes. But also an embroidery type made in Manila achieved international fame, so that in Switzerland, a type of embroidery made with the hand and shipley machine was named after Manila, as shown on this slide. Ivory could not be left out of these hybrid artistic manifestations that emerged from transoceanic collections. Ana Ruiz studies the important role played by the Sanglay, or Chinese community of Manila, in the production and trade of exquisite ivory pieces destined for the religious art market, both in America and in Europe. With a different but complementary perspective, Esperanza Bunat shows that some of the first Christian ivories made in Asia had an important influence from the iconography of India and China, as it is the case of this Niño Jesus, recognizable from the spiral hairstyle and the posture. In this sense, the Asian indigenous tradition is present in the carvings as a way of projecting an objective from one's own experience. So we talk about objects and their circulation, but rarely we do study the material artifacts that facilitated the trade, such as the way the goods were transported in vessels and containers, boxes, bags, jars, or even the folding technique of textiles. This is why Meja Priyadarshini's text is very useful to know these elements behind the big trade. We can see in the image different monograms of the jars that were used to identify the goods when they had to be unloaded in Acapulco. Monograms in Spanish, Tagalog, and Chinese have been located, and these details are very valuable as well as unusual. Finally, the works of Caroline Frank, Benito Legarda Jr., and Florina Capistrano Baker study the importance of the Manila-Massachusetts trade since the beginning of the 19th century. Within this fashion, the taste for Asian landscapes, a market for wallpaper developed in France, which was very successful in the United States. Joseph Dufour was one of the manufacturers in Paris, and his works, Les Sauvages de la Mer Pacifique, sold hundreds of copies in the United States. Here, we observe a cliché of the inhabitants of the Pacific, portrayed with exoticism, with an idea of a noble savage, with an indomitable tropical nature, represented by an erupting volcano in the background. Besides wallpapers, watercolors, Philippine watercolors were also in demand in the United States. Many works by Damian Domingo and other Filipino artists decorated the houses of merchants active in the Manila, Massachusetts trade, but some were Chinese copies, as evidenced in these images. This demonstrates that many watercolors of tipos del país, in Spanish, did not come to the United States from the Philippines, but from China as replicas. In the end of the book, closes with an afterword by Dana Leibson, which very well encompasses the main contributions of the authors and opens lines of discussion for the future. So I congratulate the editors for their great work and the publishers for making this book possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for this opportunity to talk about this wonderful book. Can you hear me? Is that?
Yes, all sounds good.
So I'm an early modernist. My field is early modern Iberian and Latin American studies. And so I wanted to talk today about why scholars in my field should read this book. So first of all, it's just a stunning, beautiful volume. The images are just really astounding. And it's the kind of book that you have to see in the flesh. Most importantly, I like to take very seriously the point made in this volume by Nina Capistrano-Baker and Meha Piyadarshini about the necessary focus on the Pacific, especially on the Spanish Philippines as a site of cultural interactions. Looking at the Philippines, not as a geographically bounded space, but as a site that ignites a web of cultural connections, not only in Asia, but also in the Spanish Americas, allows us to more broadly and deeply understand transculturation across the territory of the Spanish Empire, that the Spanish Empire had claimed as its own, as discussed by Ricardo Padrón in his chapter. This is, I think this is an image that was already shown by Paulina. It's really interesting if you see the description. This is a copy of a earlier map, but in this map is the description of the West Indies, and it includes not only the Philippines, but also parts of China, Japan, and what is today Indonesia. This is the image that Paulina showed. It's also, this is an allegory of the Spanish Empire, and you can see where the Philippines and parts of East Asia lie. There is the Philippines are the feet of the allegory of the Spanish world. So this approach, this focus on the Spanish Pacific, allows us to recognize the larger agency of non-Europeans in the Trans-Pacific trade. As Priyadarshini reminds us in her chapter, commerce between China and the Philippines already existed prior to the conquest of the Philippines. The ships that were used in the Trans-Pacific trade follow Spanish designs, but much of the technology on how to build the ships came from indigenous knowledge on how to work the local type of woods and also from Chinese labor. This approach encourages Latin Americanists to look to the Pacific as another shared site of both resistance and innovation. It also helps us understand how we find related iconography, for example, of ships and triumphal carts found in Europe, Portuguese, India, New Spain, and Peru, as it is presented in Esteban Garcia Brosseau's chapter. I want to add here that Paulina Machuca's book on Vino de Cocos also is another example of transculturation. She speaks of the Vino de Cocos as a predecessor of the mezcal, and a process that took place thanks to the Filipinos who went transpacifically to Mexico, to New Spain. Transculturation was in fact a term coined by the Cuban anthropologist Fernando Ortiz. In Cuban counterpoint, Contrapunteo Cubano del Tabaco y el Azúcar, Ortiz asserted that rather than speaking of acculturation, we should speak of transculturation. Another scholar of Latin American studies, Mary Louise Pratt, brought the use of transculturation into common use into Anglophone scholarship in her work, Imperial Eyes, Travel Writing and Transculturation. While acculturation denotes the assimilation of the dominated groups to the culture of the colonizer, transculturation, on the other hand, more accurately reflects the mutual exchange experienced by both the colonizer and the colonized. Transculturation allows us to recognize that it's not only a subjugated group, adapts itself to the master group, but the dominant culture is also changed by the cultures of the subjugated. Transculturation has been accepted as a distinctive feature of colonial Latin American experience, especially in terms of religious practices such as Candomblé in Brazil and Santería in Cuba. As Capistrano Baker and Priya Darshini show, however, and from what I have learned in my own research, such discussions would gain greater nuances if we took into account the Spanish Transpacific. Such inclusion will reveal that analogous practices took place in the Philippines in the religious devotions to the Santo Niño, which integrated from the time of the conquest, both Spanish and indigenous beliefs, or Our Lady of Casaisay, which functioned as indigenous, Spanish, and Chinese devotions, sometimes melding all three features into the same slide. I actually argue in my book that some of the devotional practices to Our Lady of Casaisay today have roots in the early modern period. As Vince Rafael shows in his contribution to this volume, empires, be they Spanish or American, struggle to impose their legitimacy in the Philippines. Ultimately, Rafael sees the Philippines as a journal space, as an entity, I quote, that peers into the past of its imperial origins while looking into the future of post-colonial possibilities, end of quote. This is certainly the case of many countries in Latin America who look into the future of post-colonial possibility, but who, like the Philippines, still struggle under the power of coloniality. Moreover, in the early modern Spanish Pacific or Transpacific, we find scenarios that complicate the colonizer versus colonized paradigm that is more commonly seen in the Spanish America, due to the fact that in the Pacific during the 16th and much of the 17th century, transculturation took place among subjects who had not been colonized by European powers. Marco Musillo's essay offers examples of two painters, Juan Zolin and Giuseppe Castiglione, whose transcultural works cannot be said to be the product of oppression. At the same time, as Musillo suggests, we need to move beyond the urge to define the European versus, say, the Chinese elements in an object and recognize the layers and integration of different features as something entirely different. This will be what Musillo calls, I quote, the transcultural engagement. But transculturation could be misinterpreted as an excuse not to investigate the historical archives that create new cultural forms, be they in the form of religious images, paintings, languages, or narratives. As Miguel Arnedo Gomez reminds us in a recent article, transculturation in its related term, mestizaje, appears in Latin American discourses as a means to cover conflicted moments with a veneer of harmony. This view could degenerate into the attitude that since the practice of melding was so pervasive, it is pointless to scrutinize where things came from and they took the shape they did. But as Capistrano Baker and Pia Darshini show, empire, and I may add the violence that accompanies it, radiates its impact in the study of transculturalism that stands at the center of this volume. And whenever possible, there is great value in understanding how transculturation came about and why. The processes that allowed a new distinctive cultural production to take place can reveal what purpose they serve the individuals, communities, or entities that embrace such phenomenon. I then end my remarks with Nina Capistrano Baker's motivating force behind her essay. What do we find when we look at the meta-narratives that underline transpacific and transcultural objects, subjects, and experiences? Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me?
You sound great.
Thank you. Good evening, good afternoon, or good morning, as the case may be. I would like to thank the organizers and sponsors of this webinar, namely the Getty Research Institute, the Kunsthistorische, I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly, Kunsthistorische Institut in Florence, Max-Planck-Institut, the Ayala Museum Foundation, and to the editors of this wonderful volume, Dr. Nina Capistrano Baker and Dr. Meha Priyadarshini, for inviting me to be part of this event. And thank you to all of you who are here. This volume participates in the exciting movement in the academic world to veer away from long-held practices of privileging certain sites, peoples, approaches, and paradigms in understanding our world. One of its merits, in the words of contributor Dana Lipson, is its advocacy to bring our attention away from a Eurocentric world by, quote, stressing instead the agentive role of people in the Americas and Philippines, and by shifting instead the centers and peripheries in the early modern world, end of quote. As the editors have pointed out in their introduction, these shifts have been happening in different fields, including in the fields that I am in, namely the fields of the Chinese diaspora in the Philippines, China studies, Philippine studies, American/Asian-American studies and empire studies. These are the fields that my own research engages in. So this volume is indeed a welcome addition to the body of scholarship that forces us to rethink our paradigms and search for broader, more inclusive scholarly agendas. For the rest of this short presentation, I'd like to focus on two areas in which the volume, as the title of my presentation says, speaks to my own research and helps us to find new as well as revive areas of exploration in my fields of study. One area that the volume particularly resonates with my own work has to do with the people that participated in this Trans-Pacific history. My first book project examines the border crossing practices of Chinese merchant families in Manila during the late 19th and early 20th centuries. In particular, I analyze how these families engaged in flexible practices, such as expressing loyalties to different states, sending their family members to live, study, work, or invest in different countries, and playing with multiple identities in order to collude with and evade the local disciplinings of colonial states or national governments. Here in the slide, you can see a photos of two Chinese merchants during that period of my study, Joaquin Barrera Lim Hap and Carlos Palanca Tan Kien Sien. Hence, through an investigation of these families' border crossing practices, I adopt an approach that is transnational. Like the different essays in this volume, my study does not privilege only one locale and instead veers away from a nation-based to a deterritorialized approach to the study of history and identity. While reading contributor Esteban Brousseau's description of the travels of Flemish Catholic gem trader Jacques de Couture to South and Southeast Asia, or contributor Caroline Frank's account of the journeys of Yankee quote-unquote China merchants, such as Edward Carrington from Providence, Rhode Island, I am reminded of the itinerant lives of the Chinese and Chinese mestizo that I study, such as the Chinese mestizo, Mariano Lim Hap, who, though born and raised in the Philippines, also traveled to Hong Kong and China, as he had both familial and commercial ties to these places. Another Chinese mestizo that I was reminded of is the Chinese mestiza Dominga Ayala. Here you can see her photo on the left, and on the right is her together with her Chinese merchant husband, Guillermo Kunyeng, and their four kids. And this photo was taken in China, where she lived for around a decade. Studies such as Brousseau's and Frank's demonstrate how approaches that are microhistorical and focus on lesser known but equally important historical actors, and that are transnational or transpacific, enrich our knowledge about the world. In my current research project that I'm looking into, that I'm working on, I look into how the Chinese in the Philippines were racialized during the 20th century and how such racialization helped justify the establishment of the American colonial state and the application of the Chinese exclusion laws in the Philippines. This research has led me to see how the history of Chinese labor migration, including that of the Philippines, has always been trans-regional and trans-Pacific. Mind you, this is not new knowledge because we have already works by scholars such as Robert Romero, Evelyn Hudehart, Monica Guinness Blasi, to name a few, who have demonstrated that Asians, including the Chinese coming from the Philippines, have had a long history of traveling across the Pacific. Recently, I participated in a webinar where we discussed the research being done by Dr. Flora Kibuyen about a Chinese from the Philippines named Choco, who went to Ternate, then to Guam, and led the insurrection against Jesuit missionaries in the 17th century. I also was a reader of Philip Gingona's dissertation, which examines Sino-Philippine relations in the first half of the 20th century, including the lives of Filipino and Chinese Filipinos who traveled and worked in China, such as Filipino jazz musicians and athletes, and Filipino-Chinese merchants such as Albino Sisip. Like the other essays in the volume, these research projects are encouraging signs of more studies that are trans-regional and trans-Pacific, and that focus on unknown or little known personages in the history of the Chinese diaspora in the Philippines. Another area that the volume speaks to me and those in my field of study is that of the study of material culture. I am not a material culture historian, but I do am very interested in such study. Certain essays, such as Meha Priyadarshini's, which mentions about the Parians in Mexico, Esteban Brousseau's essay, as well as Ana Ruiz Gutierrez's essay, that link the Philippines, the Americas, and Spain as seen through the importation of art objects like ivory Christs and virgins and Chinese porcelain from Manila, Elena Phipps' essay on Philippine fibers making their way to the Americas, and Nina Baker Capistrano's piece on the Chinese copied watercolors based on Philippine originals finding their way to Massachusetts. All of these inspire those of us in studying the Chinese diaspora in the Philippines and China-Philippine relations to also examine not only how Chinese material culture influenced Philippine material culture, as has been the tendency to do so in the past, but also how, inversely, the Philippines influenced Chinese material culture. Or, as we have seen earlier, the material culture of other places, such as the Americas. Here, I think the quote of Dr. Baker here at the bottom is worthy of reading. And she says, the significant insight this research generates is that while Chinese influences on Philippine art and culture are widely acknowledged, the reverse direction of influences from the Philippines to China is less well known and merits closer scrutiny. Because of the long-standing trade between the southern coastal areas of China and the Philippines, some products from the Philippines made their way to China. For instance, and if I'm not mistaken, in Fujian, the Hokkien term for tomato is kamatit, which is a word derived from the Filipino term kamatis. Other scholars have demonstrated in their study how other forms of Philippine material culture made their way to China. For example, James Cook and Mei Ching in their own studies have shown how villas built in the late 19th and early 20th centuries by Philippine Chinese in the cities and villages of southeastern Fujian clearly demonstrate a combining of traditional Chinese with Western and Philippine architectural styles. This type of villa is known as the Philippine villa, which is different from the Indonesia or Vietnam villas found in other parts of southeastern China. Here I would like to show a couple of slides that I took off of my own great-grandfather's villa, which he built in the 1920s in his hometown in Jinjiang, Fujian. So here you see the facade of this villa with European-inspired designs. And here's the interior of the villa. And you can also see how the interior decorations, as well as the furniture in my great-grandfather's house were made out of Philippine hardwood. I was told that my great-grandfather, who was in the lumber and construction business, also brought over Filipino masons, tilers, bricklayers, and carpenters in the construction of his villa, as well as in the construction of the villas of other people living in his village. To conclude, scholars in my field stand to gain so much in reading this volume, as they will find in the different essays read individually and collectively, the inspiration to engage in discourse with other scholars who may not share the same temporal and geographical foci or even disciplinary background as their own. But as the volume has shown, when we dare explore new dimensions and directions and work collaboratively, we discover new exciting fields of inquiry that enrich our knowledge and appreciation of this amazing world that we live in. Thank you.
Thank Thank you so much, Richard and Christina and Paulina, for these wonderful, very brief insights into the book, but I think very stimulating insights. And I especially appreciate the personal touch at the end of how these have impacted your family and this villa. That's very wonderful to bring that in. Next, I would like to call up on Nina and Meha, the editors of the book, and they will give you a little bit of a insight into the book itself and the design of the book.
Hello, I think I'll start, Meha. I'm Nina Capistrano Baker, by the way. I'm one of the editors, and Meha Priyadarshini is my partner in crime, my co-editor. So we'd like to thank our guest speakers for their wonderful comments, very insightful and discerning comments and reactions to our volume. First of all, I'd like to thank Paulina Machuca for an expansive and discerning overview and review of the volume and for citing the important concepts of engagement and translation as we transfer concepts from one cultural paradigm to another. So we were really trying to bring that out in the volume, and we're pleased that it resonated with you. Also, Paulina, for citing Manila as an active player impacting other cultures rather than merely serving as a passive melting pot. This is something we're very proud of. So we'll explore this in greater detail in the roundtable. I'd like to thank Christina Lee for situating the volume in the context of Latin American studies and recognizing the importance of learning more about the Philippine transcultural forms to illuminate and perhaps add important aspects and dimensions to Latin American studies. Yes, I did mention that or pose the rhetorical question of what do we find when we look beneath our transcultural experiences? What is there? What remains? Is it something that we could unravel, or is it a new entity that one can't really successfully unravel because they're so closely intertwined through all these engagements and contacts through history? I'd also like to thank Richard Chu for advocating this increasing shift of attention from Eurocentric perspectives, which again, the volume was deliberately trying to do, to Asian and non-Western perspectives. This was very deliberate. We really wanted to have a conversation between scholars in the mainstream dominant intellectual centers and scholars in the formerly colonized societies that often find themselves in the peripheries and unable to participate in this mainstream conversation. So this is, again, something that the book deliberately and consciously wanted to accomplish, and we're very happy that we seem to have succeeded in doing that. Richard, thank you for providing insights on the experiences of early Chinese transnational traders who were active in the Philippines, and for this enlightening discussions of early Chinese presence and contributions of Chinese-Filipino merchants and Chinese-Philippine relations. Again, also for pointing out and agreeing that the influence of China is often discussed, the influence of China on the Philippines, but there's not enough scholarship, I think, that really focuses on this two-way avenue of exchange, because the Philippines were not a passive melting pot, meeting point, but actually very proactive and impacted the cultures that we were engaging with So that was a very good point, and thank you for reiterating that. And most of all, thank you for the bonus images of your grandfather's amazing villa. And again, you know, citing the contributions of the Filipino materials, Philippine labor that went into the creation of this villa in China. So those were very welcome and very interesting comments and feedback that Meha and I really appreciate. Now, before I turn over the floor to Meha, I realize that since this is the last of the three book events to celebrating this wonderful book, I'd like to share briefly or provide a quick overview of the essays. You've seen the book itself, and Meha will discuss more of the other design aspects of the book, but I'd like to just briefly show you like some pages of the book just to give an idea of the wonderful contributions by our authors. And I'll show you some of the sections of the book that Paulina discussed with so much detail in her talk. So I'm trying to share my screen. And I think, is it on? Yes, Kim?
It's good. Okay. All good.
Good. So as I think Kim mentioned earlier, this Trans-Pacific book had a long gestation period, and starting with what I believe to have been a groundbreaking scholar theme at the Getty Research Institute. And this was the 2013-2014 theme entitled Connecting Seas, Cultural and Artistic Exchange. Kim showed you the poster for that earlier. So this scholar theme at the Getty actually generated the symposium at Ayala Museum in the Philippines that Kim and I worked on with Gerhard Wolf, was here, and other colleagues at the Getty. So many of the scholars in residence for that Connecting Seas theme were also presenters. We brought them to Manila, where they were able to interact with their local colleagues in the Philippines, which was wonderful because some of the scholars had never been to the Philippines and they had never directly interacted with our colleagues based in Southeast Asia. And we had scholars from Latin America and Europe. So it was, and of course, North America. So that was a wonderful gathering. And so let's see, maybe let's go back to here. Okay. So the conference generated or gave birth to this book. So the book includes many, but not all the topics that we covered in the conference. So the essays do not necessarily represent the conference proceedings, though the topics were inspired by that conference. And the common thread in the diverse perspectives that we present in the book is the importance of Trans-Pacific engagements to global connections in the 16th to 19th centuries and beyond. What is different and something that we're really proud of, as I mentioned earlier, is that Manila is here presented not just as a fulcrum of the Trans-Pacific network, not just a meeting point, but an active player that impacted other societies involved in the exchange. So the book was designed by Ige Ramos, and Meha will talk more about this in a bit. Okay. So let's see. The first there's a total of 20 essays, and we're so grateful to our authors for their dedication and hard work. They're based in three continents, and this was kind of challenging trying to coordinate everyone. So part one is entitled Entangled Empires, And this addresses the dynamics of imagining and resisting empires in Asia, Europe, and the Americas, such as chapters 1 and 2 by Vicente Rafael and Ricardo Padron. Part 2 is entitled Empires and Translations. And this addresses the literal and metaphorical translations from one cultural paradigm to another. For example, Jose Antonio Cervera examines how religious meanings were translated through Chinese texts. Religious meanings can also be translated and transformed through art, as Esteban Garcia Brosso examines Indian carvings as they relate to Hindu, Catholic, and European traditions. Chapters 7 and 8 by Ricky Jose and Patrick Flores examine the localization of art styles such as Philippine Rococo and miniaturismo. Chapters 9 and 10 are part of, they introduce the third part of the book, which is entitled Empires and Trade, which addresses the exchange of people, goods, art, and culinary practices. So many of the essays actually revisit the Manila-Acapulco trade from the vantage point of Manila rather than Latin America. So this again is new. And here, Feliz Prudente Santa Maria discusses culinary history, while Fernando Sialcita asserts the birth of the mainstream Christianized Filipino culture aboard the galleons. My co-editor, Meha, argues the need to rethink trade as an exchange of knowledge and expertise, not just materials, while Sandra Castro focuses on the substitution of indigenous fibers in localized textile traditions. Chapters 13 and 14 by Elena Phipps and Ana Ruiz discuss American and European demand for Asian textiles and ivory, respectively. And chapters 15 and 16 feature Esperanza Gatbonton, who explores the authorship of ivory carvings aboard the shipwrecked galleon Santa Maria, Santa Margarita. The last set of essays actually shifts the focus from the Spanish-controlled galleon trade to the U.S. presence in the Asia Pacific, such as the first essay by Caroline Frank exploring the New England trade with Asia. Ying He Zhang identifies the most prominent Cantonese export painters, which is actually a very important contribution because he bases his essay on Chinese texts that are not widely accessible to non-Chinese speakers. So this is a valuable contribution where he identifies specific Cantonese export painters and traces where their studios were. Complementing that is the essay by Benito Legarda Jr., who looks at specific U.S. merchants and their trading houses during this less known trade network between New England and Manila that actually was contemporaneous with the galleon trade and in fact continued even after the last galleons had sailed. Now the last section concludes with my chapter on identifying the Chinese copies of original Philippine export painters that were circulating in the Manila-New England trade, which is a heretofore unknown phenomenon. And we have this wonderful foreword by Dana Liebson. And so we hope that the diversity of voices and perspectives helps illuminate the complexities of the Pacific experience. And just to end, I'd like to make a plug for my exhibit. So from the initial Connecting Sea Scholar theme at the Getty, which inspired the Trans-Pacific Conference in Manila, which then gave birth to the Trans-Pacific Volume that we celebrate today. This Trans-Pacific Volume in turn inspired the exhibition entitled Intertwined, Transpacific, Transcultural Philippines that's currently ongoing at Ayala Museum until 2023. So we have time to go over there and view this exhibition. Many of the objects included in the exhibition were discussed in the Transpacific book. For example, on the right, you have this original etching of Santa Rosa de Lima, which is discussed in detail in Chapter 7 by Regalado Trota Jose. So it's a bit like the exhibition is a little bit like the Transpacific volume kind of coming to life through the objects discussed in the book, such as the portraits that you see here in the back that were discussed in the chapters by Sandra Castro and Patrick Flores, and also similar objects discussed by Esperanza Gatponton and Ana Ruiz, such as these similar ivory carvings here in the front. So with that, I'd like to turn the floor over to Maya, who'd like to add more comments on the book and respond to our speakers. Thank you.
Can you hear me okay? I know earlier my sound wasn't great, so.
Now you sound fantastic.
Okay, great. Thank you to everybody, especially to our three commenters today for taking the time to read the book. It's I'm sure Nina will agree that it's really nice after the work that went in to making the book, getting it out there, to finally sort of get some feedback on it. So we're very lucky to have the chance to do this. The book is about Transpacific engagements, but I do want to give the audience here a bit of, sort of tell you a little bit about the background, in the sense that the book wouldn't be possible without engagements of a different kind, 21st century engagements between amongst three institutions who I think actually were quite brave to take this project on. There's a lot of talk of doing global history, but it's not done, I think, in the way these three institutions were willing to do, which was really a collaboration. And these are three very prominent institutions in the places where they operate, long histories, a strong institutional culture. So it was in some ways an experiment to do it all three together, but as the book shows, it was in the end a successful experiment. So I do, to anybody in the audience who's part of a cultural institution, I would encourage you to take on more such projects where there are collaborations beyond the regions that we're familiar with or comfortable with, really sort of trans-regional collaborations. And so, having said that, I also want to say, so there were, of course, the directors of the three institutions were really supportive of the project, and without them, we could not have done this. But there were also a lot of other people who helped, and I do want to recognize them. One of them you've been hearing from, Kim Richter, today, and she's really been, I have to say this publicly, I think I've said it to her before, but she's basically been the guardian angel of this project, and it would not have been possible without her. So thank you, Kim, for that. At the other institutions, I would also like to thank Dita Samson, Jay Ente, Tenten Mina, and Joy Pena at the Ayala Museum, who were incredibly helpful throughout the process, be careful with the details that needed to be taken care of to get this book together. And again, Nina and I, you're seeing our names on the book, but really this was a collaborative effort in so many ways. And finally, at the Kunsthistorische Institut, Eva Musotter was sort of dealing with, she was kind of the center because she had to deal with all the money and sort of figure out who got it when. So thanks to all these people for keeping this together. And finally, thanks also to our book editor, because those of you who have managed to get your hands on the book have commented on how beautiful the book is, and that would not have been possible without Ige Ramos, who's done an amazing job. And I want to show you something that he has done that actually connects with a point that came up in all three of the presentations that our speakers today made. So all of them mentioned that the volume is sort of moving away from what we generally consider to be the centers of the world in the period that's covered in the volume. I think Paulina Machuca mentioned that mentioned this Pacific turn, which, as she puts it, forces us to think about the Pacific as a strategic place of multiple interactions. And Christina Lee mentioned that the Philippines is a site that, I think you said, that ignites a web of connections, but I wasn't able to write fast enough. So I hope I'm quoting you correctly. And I love the ignites there. So I might borrow that in the future. And as Richard Chu pointed out, again, that that we're not privileging, just there is some privileging of Manila because we're trying to center the attention of on the Trans-Pacific connections a bit away from Latin America, as has often been the case. But we're also bringing attention to a lot of other sites that are not considered when we think about the Trans-Pacific connection. So one way in which, so the book process, precisely because there were a lot of new sites that we were bringing attention to, we wanted a map that could sort of reflect that. But it turned out to be very complicated to do. And the book actually plays a lot with maps and space, which is great. So there's, of course, this map that centers the Pacific, which already does some work to sort of reorient how you think about the world. But it doesn't necessarily tell you all the different connections that were made possible. So one of the ideas that Ige came up with to show that was to actually come up with different maps that didn't necessarily show how the places were connected to each other geographically, right? So I don't know if you can see this. What I think what's really great about this and reflects the larger aims of the book. So here, these are the Mariana Islands, which, if you know about the Trans-Pacific trade, actually were a really important site for making the trade possible, because it was really, that's where the ships refueled. And it's what Ige has done here is given the Mariana Islands as much space, if not more, as India and China, which of course in the history of these connections loom larger, let's say, than the Mariana Islands. And this is precisely the kind of thing we're trying to do in the book, is to sort of make bigger places that you wouldn't necessarily think of as having a big impact in both in the early modern period and into the 19th century. So I think I'm going to leave it there in terms of my comments on the book. I've not kept an eye on the questions, so I don't know if there's anything left there, if we want to open it up, but
yes, let's open it up. So I ask all the presenters, participants, to turn on their cameras, please. And then I have questions, but I wanted to give preference to the audience members since we only have about 15 minutes left. But I do so appreciate how the book, the conference, but then also the book have gone so above and beyond and have pushed this, the intent that we had of shifting this conversation from the transatlantic to the Trans-Pacific. But it's gone so much farther than that and really teased out these connections in terms of artistic production and materials and people so much farther. So Christina was saying, really peeling back these layers of integration and understanding them better. Now, again, we're welcoming questions from the audience. I see some have already been answered, but we have here a comment from Teresita Ang Si that says, thank you, Christina. And she's looking forward to seeing your presentation in San Francisco at the International Society for the Study of Chinese Overseas. Again, any questions we're happy to take right now, but maybe as we wait for them to come in, I would be curious to know from our reviewers, what was the one thing that maybe surprised you most in reading this book?
Maybe I can start. many things, but since we don't have a lot of time, I just wanted to say something about a question that Sandra Castro asked me, that if I had found any records on piña clothes in Mexico or in the New Spain, and I haven't. That's what I think that the debate is open. First of all, when did the piña clothes production start in the Philippines? We don't really have like a particular date. And if the piña clothes arrived in the Manila galleon trade, that is why the chapter of Elena Fitz was really interesting, because she says that at the end of the 18th century, there is a word called Renge. Renga is the name that the Peruvian people gave to the piña textiles in the Philippines and also in Peru. So she thinks that piña clothes arrived in Peru at the end of the 18th century. I don't know, let's do more research. That was really, really interesting to do. And as this particular thing, I found in every chapter, many interesting things that I was taking notes. I just wanted to tell the editors that I read the book really slowly, taking notes of every one of the chapters. And I think that this is a great contribution to some other works that have been published, not only in English language speaking, but also in Spanish speaking. I don't know if you know this book. Mexico y Filipinas, Culturas y Memorias sobre el Pacífico, which is in Spanish. So something that I regret is that many English-speaking scholars do not have access to Spanish-speaking books. And I think that from Spain and Mexico, we have done some contributions to the Trans-Pacific interchanges, influences that go beyond the commodities. And that's all. Thank you very much.
You're muted, Nina.
Yes, so if I may jump in, Paulina, I think that question about when piña weaving started in the Philippines and its relationship to other parts of the world, whether it exists, whether the tradition exists outside the Philippines or not. And this is very interesting because that's kind of a continuation of the contacts and continuities symposium that we had for the quincentennial celebrations in the Philippines, where you were also a speaker. And so it's opened up this whole question of, wait, is piña really unique to the Philippines, or are there other white work piña traditions elsewhere? Because I think Sandra's research suggests that there were possibly Chinese and Indian piña traditions as well. So I think there's a lot of research that still needs to be done perhaps here. There also seems to be a discrepancy between the definition of renge from a Latin American perspective, which is what Elena Phipps was talking about, and the definition of renge in the Philippine dictionaries and in Philippine tradition. So there are two separate definitions for the same term. And I think this again showcases the importance of this, exactly this dialogue between scholars who are based in Southeast Asia, in the Philippines, and scholars who are based in North America and Latin America, because then it's makes it possible to compare notes and to share research and resources to kind of clarify, because obviously there's a change in, I mean, the terms mutate as we travel through time and through geography. So for example, if you have renge that has a different definition in a Mexican context versus renge in the Philippines, it would be interesting to see the dynamics of how those changes and transmutations in meaning actually occur and what their larger implications might be. And yeah, Elena is here, I think. Elena Phipps is in the audience, if you'd like to jump in the chat box.
In fact, she did already.
She did. Okay, I haven't checked. I hope I didn't misquote you.
Yeah, well, she has a wonderful question, which is, how do you think this focus on the Philippines can be more integrated into the issues of global trade and the study of colonial aspects of the Americas and beyond?
If I can answer that question, it's not, I think that people ask me, where do I begin, working on the Philippines, studying on the Philippines, and I generally say, well, if you go to any archive that deals with the Americas, they'll probably have something about the Philippines. Don't ignore it. I think that the reason why the Philippines hasn't been looked at is because it's because of the way we're trained and we go for the things that we know. And when we run into something that seems kind of unusual or different, we sort of skip it. And, anything that has to do with New Spain in the 16th, 17th, 18th century will probably have something on the Philippines. And so, when we go into these archives, you just have to go with a very, very open mind. I was just talking to a scholar recently, and she said to me, oh, I was, some of the copies of the documents in the different archives, they confuse Cebu and Cuba. So they see Cebu, they don't know what that is. And then they will put Cuba on top. And so this was a scholar of Cuban history. And she said to me, I saw this document, and it was all about the Philippines, and I don't know what it was doing in this, legajo, which was, the file was on Cuba. And I thought to myself, you should have read it. you should have read it, because it might have been something very significant. And so to me, it's really, the Transpacific is a very natural space to me. I think it's, you cannot, there is the intersectional aspect to it. It's, you cannot know about fully about the colonial New Spain if you don't know about the Philippines, and you cannot know about the Philippines if you don't know about what's going on the other part of the Pacific.
Totally agree, Christina. And just as you were saying, vice versa, you were saying how Latin Americanists in general would skip over a reference to the Philippines, and vice versa is true as well, that many, but not all, but many Filipino scholars will skip over anything that's not about the Philippines, because that's not the Philippines, so we're going to skip that. So I think this again shows how important it is to this for this conversation among scholars from both sides of the Pacific. And I'd like to also mention that your book on the Saints of Resistance was absolutely, absolutely amazing. And I think such a major contribution to Philippine scholarship, because you've gone you do as you preach. So you come through, you encounter Philippine material, and you don't ignore it, and you delve into it, and you bring out all these insights and all these details with the field work and the archival work, and you give us and the rest of the scholarly world new information and insights on Philippine traditions that we take for granted, that we've never looked at in that same way from that perspective. So I think that's just such a wonderful example of how important it is to have this dialogue and to have Filipinos and non-Filipinos and specialists of all different areas of the globe, especially Latin Americanists, to kind of look at the Philippine material and look at it from a different perspective that perhaps someone who's grown up in the culture, who's so used to it and just kind of takes a lot of things for granted, right, would not think of exploring in that way. So congratulations on that book. I love it.
Thank you. I mean, this is about your book, but thank you.
I know, but it's about, we're talking about how important it is for, I mean, what is it for Latin Americanists to look at the transcultural traditions in the Philippines? What is it, what's in it for them? And what's in it for scholars of other cultures to look at other perspectives? And that's precisely, I think, that's an illustration of how important it is to for scholars to kind of interact with each other. And I'm assuming, Christina, that when you were working on this, you were not in a vacuum. You were interacting with local scholars and getting insights from them as well, because you couldn't have managed, you know, that project just, you know, in a vacuum and just looking at things from your perspective. You also had to interact with your local counterparts. So I think that's the beauty of this opening conversations and collaborating on projects, whether, you know, being co-authors or being consultants, or just asking your colleagues and just communicating with them instead of, you know, kind of setting boundaries that, oh, I am a Philippine scholar, you're a Latin Americanist, and, you know, I do Chinese only. I think it has to be this larger transcultural, transnational conversation.
Thank you, Nia. I agree. It's a challenge. You know, like Christina, you're putting a challenge to everybody who works in these fields. And there's a lot to consider, right? Sort of going from one continent to another, but and back and forth, knowing many different languages, like Paulina said, knowing archives in all these places. So there's a lot to do to sort of absorb. And I think what you're saying, Nina, I think you're right. Also, the interchange is so productive in advancing these conversations. And I think we saw that really happening live before our eyes during our conference back in 2014, where you bring people who have these different focuses together, and then sort of magic happens, like we have in this book. So we have time for one more question, and I'm looking, it was already answered by Richard, but I wonder if there was maybe time to elaborate a little bit on this. So Sandra Castro asked if Richard knew any archival materials in Fujian province that were discovered and related to the Philippines. And this sounds really interesting, Richard, what you were responding, but maybe you could elaborate a little bit here.
Yes, and also if you look at Teresita Angsi's response, there are archival materials, and there are, of course, in Chinese. One of them is our the gazetteers, and usually these are records that are compiled every year by each county and submitted to the central government. And these gazetteers include many, many information. They're almost like census records as well. They have statistics, they have descriptions, they have events that occurred in those counties. They have stories of people or individual biographies. And as Teresita Angsid also mentioned, their foundation has published a volume. It's available, I guess, in the libraries of different Chinese archival sources in China and in the Philippines that talk about the country. And if I might add, if I may answer your question earlier, Kim, what I found surprising about this book, I mean, to be honest, when I saw it, it's like a coffee table book. And you know how coffee table books, they're super nice, but then, and oftentimes, sorry to say, but not that scholarly, you know, I mean, there's sometimes or oftentimes produced for the general or mass audience, but this one is so different because for a lack of better term, so scholarly, so academic, but without being unrelatable. It was a pleasant surprise for me to read these essays and how well they were written, how not only how well they're written, how well they're researched, but also how they also talk to me, you know, in many, many ways. So that even though I'm not a material culture historian or I don't engage in visual arts, reading these essays, even if they are in a different field, you know, they just inspire me. They spark new ideas when I read about the people that they talk about, the empires, the objects. So I highly recommend it to many people, to many scholars in different fields, because it's so relatable to different scholars in different fields. At the same time, it really spurs a lot of insights and ideas for future collaborative research or even in my own research.
Thank you for pointing this out. I remember one of the days we went to lunch. This was when the conference had wrapped up, and we went to lunch, and we were sitting there with Thomas Gietgens, who was our previous director, and Gerhard Wolf and Nina, and I remember Thomas kept saying, "We want to make this a big, beautiful book with lots of images, and we'll put, you know, money in. We want to make it beautiful." And he turned to Nina and was like, "You have to do, you have to do this." And then Meha came on board as well. But of course, we all knew that going into this, what important contributions we would have here. Congratulations to all the authors who, you know, contributed their knowledge to this book. But again, I think Meha and Nina also did, and you know, it's in the title, but they did such an important work of translation and bringing, making what maybe would have seemed incongruent, because many of these were very specific topics, and then some were very overarching and they went across time periods and areas. They did the work of translating and knitting these contributions together in a book that's not only beautiful, but also hopefully really impactful. And that's what the three institutions are all about. So I thank all of you so much for being here tonight, this evening. It's very late over where Mia is. I hope you can go to bed and get some rest now. Thank you to all the audience members for coming and joining us today in this celebration. And thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you so much.